On the recording device now. Hello, welcome to Math 2, Period 2. Okay, here we go. Today's Math 2 test question for Chapter 1, we're looking at number 5. And let's go ahead and make it nice and big. So our goal here is to write the absolute value function. This is the absolute value function as a piecewise function. So when you have piecewise function, there's that bracket, right? So this is your first piece, which it's not letting me write on there. This is your second piece, okay? So you got two pieces going on, and it's separated by your functions. So on this side, we're going to write the equation. And on this side, where it says if x is less than a certain criteria, and then if x is greater than certain criteria, these are your domains of that part, of that first piece, or of that second piece. Okay, and we can actually take a better look at it if we put it onto decimals. Okay, so let me show it to you on decimals. No, I need graphing calculator. Let's type it in. Y is equal to 3 times the absolute value of x plus 4 minus 2. Okay, so you have something that looks like this, and we have these couple critical points that they talk about. So this is the inflection point down here at negative 4. Negative 2, and then these two right here with negative 4.6670 and also negative 3.330, those are your x-intercepts. So let's go ahead and take a snapshot of this and bring it over so we have a visual here as well. Let's make it bigger. Okay, so... All right, so we have two pieces, and I don't know if you see that first piece is right here. It's separated out by this line. And the point of inflection is very critical because that tells you you go from one piece to the next piece. I want to make sure I spell point of inflection correctly. Okay, so that's the first piece. The second piece, I'll do it in yellow. Let me just try it again. Second piece. So you can see the difference. So we're going to take a look at the domain of both pieces. Okay, so the domain of the first piece, that blue part, right? Domain, you're looking at the x values, right? We're looking at the x values. So if you look at the x values, it went from negative infinity all the way to that point of inflection, which stops at negative 4. All right. And then for the yellow piece, the second piece, it started at negative 4 and then it goes all the way to positive infinity. Do you see that? So to write that domain for the first part, anything less than negative 4, right? Less than, there's your less than sign, there's your less than sign, negative 4. So everything x is less than negative 4. So it does not include negative 4 for the first piece's domain. And then if you look at the second piece's domain, it has an equal to sign. So that means we include negative 4, and it continues on all the way to positive infinity, right? So there you go. There's that arrow that indicates that it's going to be bigger. That's the arrow right there. And so that is going to be also negative 4. So that point of inflection is actually where the domain kind of split into two. Okay. Any questions up to here? Any questions about the domain? No questions? Okay. Now, if you look at the first piece, right? The first piece, let's go ahead and exit out of here. Oops, wrong one. So I can go to decimals to show you. So the first piece, if we were to continue this line all the way, right? So if I zoom out a little bit, if I were to continue this line, so we have to figure out what is the equation. So because we know it's a negative, right? Negative slope. So let's see if we can figure this out. There is a point here. Let's see. Let me see if I can help you. Something like that. And bring it over here. The easiest way to do this is actually on your paper, okay? You take a ruler. Okay, you take the ruler, and what you're going to do is you're going to extend that line. Okay, so I'm doing that first piece in blue right now. So this is the first piece right here. You guys see that? So I'm using a ruler. That's how I draw so straight. Okay, and I'm just going to extend that line. Okay, my extension of the line, I'm doing dots to kind of see where it crosses the y-axis. Because the easiest way to figure out the equation of the line, right? So equation of the line from math one, you guys remember, is y equals mx plus b, right? So you need to look for your slope and your y-intercept. So what I'm doing here is I extended the line so I can look for my y-intercept. All right. And my y-intercept is all the way down at negative 10, negative 11, negative 12, negative 13 right here. Okay, so that's my b. My b is negative 13. And we need to still look for our slope, right? Our slope is, so you can pick where it actually crosses the point. And I think you can kind of see it went down 1, 2, 3. So down 3 means negative 3 to the right 1. So right 1 is positive 1. So your slope is down 3 over to the right 1, which makes it negative 3 over positive 1, which you can reduce. Slope is just going to be 3. So once you have these two pieces of information, you found your slope, you found your y-intercept, you can just put it into this linear equation format. And in case you forget, f of x is the same as y. Okay? And all we have to write on the other side is simply, because this is already y equals over here, all we have to write is just a slope times x plus b. So what we're going to write over here is just going to be slope is 3, x is this term right here, plus, or in our case, minus 13. Or you can have plus minus 13, but you can simplify it a little bit more. Okay, I don't know if you guys can see that. 3x minus 13, or you can have 3x plus negative 13 is the same. Any question about that first piece? Any questions? Okay. The second piece, is this yellow piece right here that we saw earlier? Oops, my I moved it. Sorry, give me a second. I'll move it back. There you go. So second piece is this piece right here. I don't know if you guys can see it in the. Yeah, okay. So you do the same thing. You're still looking for a slope and also y-intercept. So I see the y-intercept the easiest is right here at 10. So b equals to 10. And then my slope, the easiest way to find the slope is actually using that same point right here and move it up this way, right? So if you look at to the right, one is positive one. And then we go up one, two, three. So up three means it's positive three. So slope is up three to the right one. And then, so you get 3/1, which is just slope is equals to three. And we have our B, which is our y-intercept at 10. So what happens here is you have, you can formulate the equation to be, y equals to 3x plus 10, and then all you have to write is you already have y equals over here, so all you have to write is just the 3x plus 10 over here. 3x plus 10. Any questions on how to find the slope and y-intercept of your pieces, and then how to find the pieces, the domain? Last call on this question, number 5. Does that help? Does that answer your questions about number 5? Last call, last call. Good, good, good. Okay, so we have a request for 14 and then a 15. So that's coming up next. So let's go ahead and dive in to the second page. Let me move it out. Let's go ahead and go to 14, and then we'll go to 15 after. So let's take a look at 14. So 14 has two pieces. Oops. This is our first piece. I want to make it as big as possible. And then we have a second piece right here. Wrong. Let me just delete. This is number 14. Okay. Okay, so our goal is to rewrite y equals to 0.7 raised to the t plus 3 power. They say to put it into either this format, which by the way is exponential growth, and then is growth is adding the rate, decay is subtracting the rate. They want you to also tell whether the model represents exponential growth. So you need to. Let me do this. Tell if it's exponential growth or exponential decay right after. So there's two things, right? This is the first one we gotta do, and then we gotta tell. So first and second. So we want to rewrite the equation. So the equation, if you look at all the equations, they have t by itself, right? Right now, t is not by itself, so you gotta use your formulas. Or not formula, the properties, right? So we gotta remember the properties. So let's rewrite this. Y is equal to 0.7 raised to the t plus 3 power. And when you have a plus sign here, we know we can use the product property, okay, of exponents. And what that says is when you have a plus sign, you can rewrite the base twice. And the product, meaning multiplication. So that's where we come back in. And then what happens with the t is we put the t right here and we put the 3. So we can separate out the exponents. So it's an exponential property. You gotta remember that. And go back and review that section a little bit more. And then after that, all we have to do is just simplify, okay? Simplify, because this actually comes out to a number. So usually we'll put the number out in the front, then the variable. So I don't know off the top of my head what that is, but you have Desmos calculator for that, math tools, scientific calculator, and just punch it in 0.7, and then you can raise it using the a to the b power right here to raise the power, or you can use shift 6 to use a caret. And then raise to the third power. There you go. You have 0.343 is out in the front. We bring down the y, okay? And then the 0.7 raised to the t power comes to the back because that has a variable in the back. Okay, so there you go. Some people were saying how to find the equation for 14. How do you round to? So there's the, how to find it, and then rounding. I don't think they rounded to any other crazy ones. 343. So let's see. Big ideas math. Yeah. So they did 343. And then the thing that they did for that 0.7 is we got to change it to one of these, right? 0.7 is less than one, so we got to subtract. So let's make sure we do that part before we box our answer. So y is equal to 0.343 times, and since 0.7 is less than one, we know it's going to be the decay. Okay, so we just set whatever that is. So it's exponential decay. All right. So we use the 1 minus r, and then we set it equal to whatever's inside, and so for r. So subtract 1 on both sides, you get negative r equals to negative 0.3, and then divide both sides by negative 1. You get R is equal to 0.3, and that's what you did. You put 1 minus R, and our R that we found here is 0.3, and that's it. That's what you would put together for your equation. Okay. Are there any questions on how they explained and how to round? And by the way, we just found the second part, which is a function represents an exponential decay. Okay. How do we know which one is the first piece? Oh, are you talking about the previous question? Great question. Okay, so if you have any further question on number 14, you can also leave it in the chat or put it into Pear Deck. I will see both. And I haven't forgotten number 15. Okay, number 15 is coming up. We had a question that says, how do we know which one is the first piece? Great question. Okay, so on the previous slide, to know which one is the first piece, you have to look at which function comes first from left to right. Okay. So the function that came first is the blue piece from left to right. Oops, sorry, that was terrible writing. Okay, so because left is the smallest, we always go from smallest to biggest. So smallest to biggest. Right. So smallest to biggest. So that's how we tell. So the blue piece came first, right? If you actually sweep it across, blue piece came first and then the yellow piece. Does that answer your question? How can you draw like that with a mouse? I'm not on a mouse. I'm on a tablet. I know, I have to invest in a lot of things to teach you guys online. So that's one of the things we invested. That's okay. It's for the better because I can't draw like this on a mouse. This will be insane. That's okay. Any additional question on wall number five? Okay, continue to ask me question. Okay. All right, we're moving on to number 15. That was also requested. So let's take a look at number 15. Cassandra, you okay? You're okay. Don't worry. I'm glad that you're back. And by the way, this is all recorded. So in case you, because you got, like internet situation, you got kicked off or whatnot, you can always come back and review, okay? And I'll try to have it uploaded. Well, as soon as I fin click, unclick or stop recording, then we will be able to have it uploaded. So it just depends on the YouTube rendering time too. Okay, so you have to consider the following function, f of x equals to negative of absolute value of 2x minus 1, all of that plus 1. So you want to graph the value for which value of x for which f of x equals to oh sorry, less than negative 4. So that if you don't like f of x, just think of it as y less than negative 4. Okay, y equals to negative absolute value 2x minus 1. Okay, since we only have one function, we can change it back to y. So f of x is just another name for y. So if you don't know that, this is what happens, after you graduated from sixth grade math. Okay, so we move on to f of x. That's all. Okay, but okay, so let's take a look at what happens to this function on decimals, right? You could use decimals and oh, let's use the decimals graphing calculator. And I should probably log in so I can save this and you guys can have this. I always date it so that way I know which day that we did this on. So period two, chapter one, test correction. Okay. So I'll give you guys this link in the chat, those of you who want it. Yes, I do post these onto Google Classroom. Let me show you where to find it one more time on your Google Classroom under each day's assignments. Do you see how it says today's recording will appear here when loaded? The link will appear there when loaded. Okay. Just like your Jamboard, I give you the link, right? Just like your quizzes, I give you the link. So your recording, once it finish recording, it'll upload here. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So ask me any other additional questions you have about anything. Okay. All right. So we have this function that we were trying to draw on here. So I'm going to close this one off so it doesn't get confused. You don't get confused. I don't get confused. Okay. Absolute value 2x minus 1 plus 1. Okay, so we have something that looks like this. Okay. And when they ask us to let's do this. Okay. You can't see this, but we will try. Okay. Let's make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so when they're asking you that, hey, you should have the value of x, right? Remember, this is your x-axis. Okay, the other one obviously is your y-axis. And so when they ask you for x-axis such that the y, right? So remember f of x means y is less than negative 4. So on this side, where the y-axis, right? We want y that's Less than negative 4. So y that's less than negative 4, I'm going to do a dotted line here. So this is y equal to negative 4. So anything below this is going to be less than negative 4. Okay, so they want you to graph only the value. So graph, oops, oh, sorry, I moved it on accident. Graph the value of x, right? That y is less than negative 4. So that's basically just this part only and this part only. We don't care anything above that green dotted line. Do you see that now? So I think if we did this correctly, let's check with Big Ideas Math. So the x values are, is it negative 2? Let's check. It looks like negative 2. Let's see. Let's draw this. Yeah, so it is at negative 2. So this is negative 1. This one next door is negative 2. And then on this side is 1, 2, 3. So everything less than negative 2, close circle, because we have value exactly negative 2. We also have value. Oh, no, it's not close circle because we don't have an equal to sign here. Okay, so it's a dotted line for a reason. Sorry, I put a dotted line for a reason. Dotted line is when there's no equal to sign, right? When there's no equal to sign, so there's, nothing there. There's so it's not a closed circle. It's actually an open circle. Sorry about that. Open circle because there's no value at exactly negative 4. And same thing on the other side. It also should be open circle because there's no value there at negative 4. But it has value everywhere, you know, that goes all the way to negative infinity, right? So, positive infinity. And then the other one goes all the way to negative infinity. So even though, yes, it's going down, but they're looking at the x value. So there's x value all along this, right? There's x value all along this. So meaning that if I take a like a sweeping straight line, like I go over, right? Or if you want to think about it as vertical line test. There we go. Vertical line test. If I were to draw vertical line test, there's always value of x, right? All the way to negative infinity. So you use vertical line test. Okay, for your x values. And then if you draw a vertical line test on the other side, there's always going to be value all the way to the positive infinity too. Okay. So when you graph the function, it should look something like this, right? Open circle at negative 2, everything to negative infinity. Open circle at positive 3, everything to positive infinity. Just like how I did it right here, but you guys don't know if you saw it. Oh, let me use a... Yeah, so there is your horizontal graph, okay? Maybe I should use a different color, I don't know. So you can see it. So at negative 2 and also at positive 3. Okay, let me know if you have any questions about number 15. Does that answer your question, additional questions? So you ignore those value past negative 4. Yes, because that's what they told us up here, right? They told us up here, your y value is less than negative 4, right? So you got to keep in mind, less than negative 4 means going below negative 4. So we don't care what happens to these guys that's, you know, above negative 4, because you got to look at the criteria right here, okay? Does that answer your question? Okay, is there any additional questions about your chapter one test that you need to ask now so that way you could be ready for your retake test on Friday and do a way better job than you did than as a class, because right now as a class we got about 36.9 degrees. I mean percentage. Okay. So seeing none, what is determined as the cone equation? What number is that? So that way we can focus on that one. 17. Okay, so we have a request for 17. Which expression represents a volume of the cone where r is the radius, h is the height? So, great question. Let's go ahead and try to dive into this. And I think you're saying what is determined as the cone equation. Okay, so we're on slide 4. This is number 17. Okay, let's take a look. What is the equation of a cone? Well, I don't know off the top of my head, so you can just put it into the, Google, right? So equation, wait, what are they looking for? Are they looking for volume? Yeah, volume of the cone, right? So you gotta be careful. You gotta look at what they're asking for, right? So volume of the cone, because there's also surface area of the cone. So volume, somebody already looked it up. I didn't look it up. Let's see. Oh my goodness, Google gave you the equation right there. So V is equal to pi r squared times h over 3. Predicted what exactly what you wanted to find, right? So, okay, let's go back. So there you go. So which expression represents a volume of the cone where r is the radius? So that's a key right here. R is the radius. So this is the radius right here. This is your r. And then h is your height. Okay, h is your height, which is this one right here. That's your h. Okay, so we didn't need to do much with h. Okay, but what we need to do is we need to substitute in this r into here. Okay, so let's just write that in. We didn't do anything to v. Oops. Let me use the right pen. We didn't do anything to v. We didn't do anything to pi, but our r square, we're going to do something to it. Our r square is now h divided by 4. So if you just substitute it in, you can just leave it as that. But because it's a squared term right here, we want to make sure we distribute that square out. Okay, so what happens to that is you get a second equation. V is equal to, and then the h, the numerator gets squared, the denominator also gets squared, and then h over 3. Then you can simplify. Okay, simplify. Let me move it over here. Simplify. My eye always disappear. I don't know why. Okay, so combine like terms, okay? So V is equal to pi. By the way, all this are like hidden multiplications in between, okay? Hidden multiplication meaning that you can actually just multiply the numerator with the numerator, denominator with the denominator. So H squared, there's two H right there, meaning there's H times H right here in the H square. There's another H here. So if you have H times H times one more H, you get H cubed. Okay, in the denominator, you have 4 squared, that means 4 times 4, and then you just multiply across, by the way, so and then multiply times 3. So 4 times 4 is 16, times 3 is, this one's spa, G-E, this is spa, 48, I think. But let's check with decimals, because I don't want to be wrong. I don't like to be wrong. I like to be right. 48. Double checked. All right. So there you go. So we simplified. Then the final answer looks something like this. And they're asking us in the big ideas math, which of the four is true, right? So let's take a look. of our options. Pi times h over 3 divided by 48. So that's correct. We just found that at the end of our journey, right? Once we simplify everything. And then, well, 16 times pi times r. Well, we know that 16 was actually in the denominator earlier, right? Right here is in the denominator. So we know that if the 16 is a numerator, that's not the correct one. Okay. So, and then for this one, pi h squared times 12 is also a common mistake because some people, they don't remember to make sure that the 4 gets squared as well. So when they multiply that across 4 times 3, they got 12. And that's incorrect because 4 also gets squared in. Okay, so 4 gets squared, so you get 16 times 3, which gives you the 48. So they bank on you guys making those silly mistakes. And then you have, what is this? 4 third pi r cubed. How do they get 4 third pi r cubed? How do they get 4 third pi r cubed? That's a good question. Hang on. How do we get 4 third pi r cubed from r? There's an r. There's an r. But we already substitute r with h divided by 4. H over 4. 4 third pi r cubed. Oh, I know what happened. Okay, sorry. Alarm just went off in my head. Okay, you see how earlier we have this equation down here, right? And then they left us with the r. So that means we got to solve for h here. So h over 4 equals r, and we solve for h. Then we get 8. Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention the intermediate step. The intermediate step is we just multiply by 4 on both sides, okay? And then we get this cancel, h equals to, usually put number 4 first. For r. So once you have this, this is the intermediate step. And we're still going to plug it into our original equation. So this is the second round, I guess. So let me put it like this so it doesn't get confused. So the second answer. Okay. We're still using that equation that we found on the internet. V is equal to pi r squared h over 3. But this time, what we're going to substitute in for our h is going to be our 4r. We're going to substitute that in there. Okay, so what we have is v equals to pi r squared, and then we have 4r that we substitute in. Actually, let me use blue. So that way you know that's what we substitute in for r. And then we still have that divided by 3. And all these are still hidden multiplications, right? And that's how they get, let's simplify a little bit. Okay, let's simplify a little bit. Okay. So you have multiplication across. We have r squared that we saw earlier was r, times one more r here. So you get r to the third power. Usually we like to put the numbers first. So 4 goes out in the front. Pi is also a number. Pi goes in between. And then equals to v is on the other side, divided by 3. So there you go. That's how they got the four-thirds. What is it? Four-thirds pi r cubed. Okay. So that division, you can actually pull it all the way up to the front. So all the numbers up in the front, pi r cubed. Okay. Does that answer your question a little bit? On number 17, the person who asked. Let's see. Okay. All right. Let me know if you have further questions. If not, we can dive into today's lesson for a little bit on 2.1. Do you have further questions about chapter one test corrections? Any questions? Okay. Well, let's dive into our dashboard and see what question you guys missed. The first one? Okay, well, let's see if we can answer that question for you. Okay. No other questions on chapter one? Last call, your last chance. Okay, do better on Friday. All right, so let's go ahead and go into 2.1. Adding and subtracting polynomials. Okay, and go for it. So we have something that looks like this. 4x minus 2x to the third, the whole entire quantity is added to the other quantity, 5x cubed minus 4x plus 5. So the way that I like to help my students is I like to combine like terms, okay? So if you're not sure how to combine like terms or what are like terms, so step one, combine like terms. It'll help you with this method, okay? This method works like charm for many of my students. Okay. Yay. Thank you. Okay, so anything that has just 1x, we're going to box it. Do I see another 1x? I see another x to the first power. And I also recommend that you include the sign in front of it. The reason why we do that is just to make adding a lot easier. Okay. So we have an addition right here, right? So you have 4x to the first plus negative 4x to the first is the same thing as minus 4x. So that's a first step of combining like terms. I'm not even doing anything yet. I'm just identifying the like terms. Okay. The next type of like terms is anything to the third power. Oh, whoops. I should have gone from third power, but it's okay. We're going to circle those. Okay. Anything that has a third power x, we're going to circle those. So I have negative 2x to the third plus 5x to the third. Anything else that's left over, we're going to put this is just a number plus 5 in the back. And I messed up on one thing. Usually we like to do the higher power goes first. So this is the degree or power of the x. So usually we like to put the higher degree first. So highest degree first. So I'll change that right now. When I combine it. Oops. Okay, so we'll do that. What's negative two something, right? So this is just something. We don't care what it is. But you have negative two of it plus five more of it. All you have to do is just negative two plus five, which is three, right? So three of that something. Right, so it goes back down into just adding and subtracting your integers, right? So we put the highest term first, okay, And then the next highest term is a 1, so that comes in next. But the thing is, if you have 4x to the first power minus 4x to the first power, this comes down to nothing, right? This is just, oops, sorry. This is just 0, right? So do I need to write 0 again? Technically, no, but if you want to know that it's there, you have 0 x, okay? And then last is your plus 5. So your final answer will come out to be just 3x cubed plus 5, because you do not need to write that plus 0. And we do see that right here, 3x cubed plus 5. How do we feel about this question? You can either give me thumbs up or Pear Deck, up to you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I got 8 people, 9 people participating. Engaged. Thank you for showing me that you're here participating. Okay. No questions. Let's move on to the next one that you have questions on, which I think is number 6. Okay, how do we simplify these expressions? And you're just like, oh my God, I don't know. But it's okay, we'll learn and we'll know. Okay, so just like before, combine like terms, okay? We have 6x plus 4x to the fourth minus 3x squared plus, forgot the parentheses, 7x to the fourth plus 5x squared plus 8x. Okay, so what was our first step? We have to what? Combine like terms, right? And you gotta identify which one is the like terms, and feel free to use what we did earlier. So let's do the highest power first, okay? So I don't mess up again. So highest power is, I see, is a 4, right? You look at the exponents, okay? So I see the 4 power. So I'll put a circle. Oh, sorry, I forgot. Always include the sign in front of it. Okay, so I have 4x to the fourth plus 7x to the fourth. That's the first one. Second one, I see the highest term is 2. That's the highest degree. So I'm going to box it. That was a terrible box. Oh, let me do a triangle. How about that? Triangle. So I got negative 3x squared plus 5x squared. Okay. And then I see a x term, which is hidden one, by the way. So I will do a box this time. And there's a first term. So I have plus 6x plus 8x. Do you see how we combine like terms? And also recommended put into writing. Recommend to put in order of highest degree to lowest degree. It just makes your life a little bit easier. So highest degree is the 4, lowest degree is the 1, and just go in order, okay? All right, so let's go ahead and simplify now. Step 2, simplify, I guess. Simplify, simplify. Okay, so let's go ahead and simplify. We have equals to 4x to the 4. So remember, just 4 something plus 7 something is 11 of that something, and that something just happened to be x to the fourth. That's all. Okay, think of it that way. It'll be a lot easier to help you focus. And then negative 3 something plus 5 something. We just talked about that one was positive 2 of that something x squared, right? And then 6 something plus 8 something, that is going to give you 14 of that something. Oops, I think we boxed these guys. And that's it. That's your final answer. 11x to the fourth plus 2x squared plus 14x. And that's your final answer. Do we have this final answer somewhere? 11 to the fourth power, we eliminated that one. 2x squared, eliminated that one. And 14x, so it's this one. Any questions about this one? How do we feel about this one? Now that you see, you know, we have two steps basically, right? We have to combine like terms, right? Put it in order and then simplify. Thank you, 6 people, for your immediate feedback. Thank you, 14 people. Jonathan, can you turn on your camera since I don't see you participating? Those of you who are not participating, I'm gonna ask you guys to turn on your cameras so that way I know that you're there, that you can do better, okay? Because first chapter, whatever you guys were doing, did not work. Because 32% as an average, that tells me we just wasted the first month of learning. Let's not waste time, okay? Time, once it's passed, it does not come back. All right, so my challenge for you right now is go ahead and try to do this next one. This one is baby simple equation that you can add. Try it yourself. Okay, I'm going to help you set it up. That's it. Put it into the Pear Deck, please. So, by the way, when I see the word AND, it's math for addition. Okay. See if you can add these two together. Should not be missing this now. Combine like terms. What are the like terms? What are the like terms? Good job. Jianan, you got this. Good job, Adrian, you got this. Type, and good job, Jacob. You got this. William, close, but no. Just FYI, this has a second power. Oops, let me use a different color. So this term is different than, So because it has a second power, it's a different term than this one. This is a hidden one. So there, I should use different colors. So that way you know there's a different term and different shape. Okay, so those two are different terms. The only thing that you can combine like term is the number 3 and the negative 2. Okay, so you go from the highest order. X squared goes first because it has a second power. And then, let me do it in the color so that we can see it, x squared. And then plus x to the first power because it's the highest. And then finally you have negative 2 plus 3. So you can combine these two numbers and that's it. Everything else just stays as it is. And technically you do not need to write that one up there if you don't want to. So you should have the final answer, x squared plus x plus 1, okay? And our answer is actually, oh, you, yuck, right here. Okay, something's wrong with my tablet. I'm gonna try to go to the next page and come back. Okay, there you go. How do we feel about this now that you see it explained once more? Thank you, thank you, thank you. I got 9 responses immediately. Okay, we'll do another one. Yeah, it's okay. So you can remember, drag your dots to, you know, like, do you need one more? Need two more? You're good to go. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for your feedbacks. Okay, so let's do one more of these. See if we can. We'll come back to number 8, and then we'll do number 9. Okay. Because number 9 is kind of the similar, but it's a little bit more on the crazier side. Not as, you know, nice and neat. Not 2 terms, but now we have 3 terms. Yuck. But you can do it. Okay. Let me give you the Pear Deck. Try it one more time. Show me, show me, show me. You got 3x squared plus xy minus 5y squared plus 2. Oh, sorry, I forgot parentheses. X squared minus xy plus 3y squared. How do you know which one do I go first? Because I see square terms. I will tell you a hint. Alphabetical. Alphabetical order. Okay. X comes first before Y in alphabet. So X square term goes first. Okay. X square term goes first. So you got 3x squared. That's my hint for you. Okay. And I'll stop doing it. I'll let you try it. Oh, by the way, those of you who have hard time typing the square or hard time writing it, you can type it like this. So 3x squared plus 2x squared. Or you can just do the work. I'm sorry, whoops, x. The caret is how do you say? Shift 6, okay? So to get the caret, let's learn how to type. How to type caret is, oops, is use shift and 6. Somebody's knocking outside my window. Why? Nobody should get up to second floor. Ooh, very nice, very nice. Let's see. Very good job. Jimena, very good job. Joshua, very good job. Uh-oh. So when you add like terms, you gotta remember this is 3 something. Okay. So 3 something plus 2 something, you don't get 2, you know, like 5 something squared. This becomes 5x squared. It's not x to the fourth, okay? Just FYI. Okay, so double check that. Cameron, try again. Your final answer. And my hint for you also is to always include the sign in front of it. So note. Special note, always include the sign in front of it. The term, always include the sign in front of the terms. Okay, so this is extremely important to help you. That's why it's in red. Yes, Diana, very good. Jacob, very good. Isabel, very good. Excellent. Daniel, very good. Good job, Jesus Franco. Okay, very good, Timothy. Very good, Adrian. Excellent, Emily. And very good job, William. Okay, so, I want to show you guys this person's work because this person's doing a really good job on here. So let me show you right here. Okay, and let me know if you want me to give you the credit. I can certainly give you credit where credit belongs. So if you notice, this person, they added the like terms, right? They use the colors too to help them figure it out. So use colors if it helps you. So this is I'm gonna go with their colors. Okay, so this is five. Oh, sorry. Let me shimmy this up. Right, those of you who are more used to seeing it like this, 2x squared. So you get 5x squared right there. And then what happens with this xy term in the middle? Because you have one xy minus one more of that thing. So when you have one of that thing minus one more of that same thing, that's it cancels out. So that becomes zero. So you don't see it anywhere in the final answer at all, right? And then they did minus 5y squared, combine it with 3y squared. Remember, it's negative 5 something plus 3 of that something. Negative 5 plus 3 is negative 2 of that something y squared. And that's how we get the final answer. Okay. So let me know if it's okay for me to say your name. Just type yes in the Pear Deck. That's your work. I want to give you your credit. Let me know. Is that okay? Yeah, the exponents do not change. It's only when you multiply, then that's when it changes. Right now, we're just adding and subtracting. That's why I haven't done multiplication. Great question. The exponents do not change when combining like terms. When we're adding and subtracting, the exponent stays the same. When we're multiplying, I think not tomorrow, not Friday, since you're retaking your test. So most likely Tuesday. No, sorry, not Tuesday. Not Monday, because usually we save our Mondays for my Mindfulness Monday. And then so the next time we'll do multiplications a week from now, next Wednesday. It's okay. So that way you got plenty of time to make sure you got your adding and subtracting down, right? Okay, so the person didn't respond, so I'll just leave him or her anonymous. Okay, how do we feel about these problems now when it's just adding? Good. I got lots of feedback. Thank you in the Google Meet as well. More understanding. Okay. Well, do you want to try again or you want me to go over another one? Should we do one that's subtracting? Do we have any that's subtracting? There is one that's subtracting. You let me know. What would you like? Would you like to do the fast and curious, or do you want to do a subtraction and then fast and curious? What would you like to do? Okay, let's do one subtraction. Thank you for your feedback. Okay, let's do one subtraction so that way we know what to do when we got to it. Okay, subtraction is very similar to addition, okay, with one caveat, step zero. Okay, so with subtraction, we have 4x squared plus x. Who likes subtraction? I don't. That's so negative. No pun intended there, but it just happened. Okay, so step zero. Okay, you need to change that negative sign, that negative attitude, into positive or addition sign. Okay, and how do we do that? Great question. We do that by distribution. Okay, so we distribute that hidden negative one right here. We distribute it in, okay, by distribution. So that's the only thing different, okay? That's the only thing different. And after that, you can just add like normal. So let me show you what I mean, okay? So 4x squared plus x, we haven't done anything to that first part. We just leave that there. So negative 1 times x squared becomes negative x squared, right? Or you can have that hidden one there too. Negative 1 times positive 2, right? Negative times positive is negative. 1 times 2 is 2. X. Okay. So we distributed it out. Now, just like before, step one, combine like terms. Okay. So step one, combine like terms. And it's just back to normal again. Okay. So combine like terms. I see a square term. So I got to do those guys first. Make sure you include the sign in front of it. So I have 4x squared minus hidden 1x squared. That goes first. And then I have another one that is with x, right? To the first, x to the first. So plus x minus 2x. By the way, there's hidden 1 there in case you forgot. Okay. The parentheses are telling you those are your grouping symbols. That's why we need the parentheses around it. Okay. And once we distribute that, we can actually take off that parentheses. That's a good question. Okay. So you don't just have that negative one distributed only to the x squared term. You also have to distribute that one to the 2x term. So that's why there's parentheses around this. Okay, just in case you forgot your order of operation, right? Order of operation, parentheses, exponents, multiply and divide your from left to right and subtract. So when you're simplifying, you gotta take care of your grouping symbols. Your grouping symbol have parentheses, you can have brackets, you can have braces, and we also have absolute values. Those are all your grouping symbols, okay? So anyways, let's continue step two, which is just to simplify step two. Make our life easier, simplify, right? And you get 4 something minus 1 something. 4 minus 1 is 3 of that something. My something is x squared. And then on the other side, plus, you have 1 something minus 2 something. 1 minus 2 is negative 1 of that something, which is x. Anytime that you have a plus right next to a negative, is a negative. Okay? So this final answer will just be 3x squared minus, technically you don't need to write that 1, just minus x. And we have that right here. Any questions about this? Do you need another subtraction? Or are you good to go? Drag your dots. Thumbs up, you're good to go. Drag your dots if you need another. Put it in the middle. Okay, let's see if I can find you another one with subtraction. Oh, I see another one. Do you want to do 19 or 20? Which one? No worry. Let's do 20 because it's a little bit less terms. Let's do that one. Okay. See if you can do this by yourself first and figure it out. I'm not sure. Sorry, Lance. I don't know why you're having a issue refreshing all the tabs. You might have did some keyboard ninja stuff on accident. Sometimes that happens when you just like boom, and then you're like, oh my God, everything disappeared for me. Okay, try it, try it, try it. You have x to the fifth plus x to the third minus the quantity of x, oh sorry, 6x my oops, minus x to the third plus 6x to the fifth. So remember, yeah, step one is to what? Oh, sorry, step zero. Distribute that negative sign into the rest to make minus turn into positive. Hi, Lance. As soon as we finish this one. Thank you. So please try it. Yeah. So there's that hidden one, right? That we gotta distribute all the way in for all of them. So what's negative one times 6x? Negative 6x, all right? What is negative one times negative x cubed? Negative negative makes a positive x cubed, right? Because there's a hidden negative one, just in case you did not know that. Okay, and then finally we have negative one times negative six, I'm sorry, positive six x to the fifth. So we get negative six x to the fifth. Okay, so after that, all you had to do is combine like terms. So I help you with that first step, but you know what to do now. Step one, combine like terms. Oh, yeah, Lance, you're just having issues today, huh? Okay, so combine like terms. And I'll record this. Well, it is being recorded still, so you can watch the recording. We have the highest term, which is 5. So x to the fifth. And I see another one right here. So negative 6x to the fifth. Or minus 6x to the fifth. The next highest term I see is a 3. Include the sign in front of it. I see another one. Include a sign in front of it. So plus x cubed plus x cubed. And then finally, our last term is with just by itself, negative 6x. Okay. And then I forgot to write it down. Simplify, simplify. Step two, simplify. So when you simplify, this is, by the way, a 1 something minus 6 something. So you get negative 5 of that something, which is x to the fifth. Uh-huh. And then this, by the way, there's a hidden 1 of that something plus 1 of that something. So I get a total of 2 of that something. So it's 2x to the third. And then we don't have anything else, so the negative 6x comes down. And your final answer is just going to be negative 5x to the fifth plus 2x to the third minus 6x. Any questions about how to do this one? Some of you guys got it. I see it in the paradox, so good job. Yes, I know today's lesson ran a little bit long, but I hope that you learned something today. And we will play the quiz is again on next week. Okay. You're actually dismissed because I am over time. And thank you so much for staying on. I appreciate it all the way to the end. Bye.